Today's live broadcast, I'm Sandy Barry Blackley, Chief Knowledge Officer of Lexercise. We're delighted to have everyone with us today. I want to welcome Janet Sankar to today's live broadcast. She's going to be presenting about the Livescribe pen. Janet is Director of Professional Services for Livescribe and is an educator who has 16 years experience in the classroom and now helps educators use this technology, and educators and others use this technology. We're delighted to be hosting this live broadcast. As our users know, we work with a lot of people of all ages who have language processing problems, and while we're often able to help them become great readers and spellers and writers, they often continue to have trouble managing their resources and listening to lectures and that kind of thing. And so this sort of technology is wonderful. And one of the things that we do at Lexercise is help connect our users to technology that helps them. So we are really happy to be getting a little bit more educated on the Livescribe pen. And Janet, with that, you can take it away.
So I just would like to introduce myself. My name is Janet Sankar, as she said. I am the Director of Professional Services for Livescribe, and so here is my contact information if you need to reach me. This webinar is also being recorded, so if you need to go back to the recording to get this, you can as well. And I
after
did open with this
we're
slide that I heard
this
from Tina. Tina, thanks
finished,
for putting
we'll
in there. And I asked, what makes a pen smart? Go ahead and type into the chat box your answer to this quick question. Doesn't have to be long. Her answer is two words, and it's memory aid. That's a great, great definition of what makes a pen smart. Anybody else want to throw that in there? And just put in a recorder. Sounds like some of you guys might know something about the smart pen already. Linda says, records auditor and user notes. A decoding assistant. Got some good answers coming in there. So it sounds like some of you might have already heard about it. The possibility of the pen to transform thoughts and ideas into something tangible that a student can refer back to. I love these answers. So let's take a look at today's roadmap. We're going to be together for the next hour, and we're going to cover four main topics as we go through the next hour. I'm going to start with just an introduction of the technology. So how does the technology work? It's a fairly simple technology. It only has three pieces to it, so it's very easy for people to catch on to because they're very accustomed to using pen and paper already. And then we'll go through on the process of recording notes and audio. So that's almost like a little mini training in a sense of how the pen works with the paper. So after discovering the three different elements, we'll talk about how they work. And then in section three, we'll go into our digital notes. So once you take the pen, use the pen to take notes with pen and paper, then you can actually digitize those notes and upload them to a computer. And so we'll move into talking about ways that you can do that and then what you can do from them from there in terms of sharing notes and playing them back and using them for review. And then finally at the end, I'll just talk about a few common uses that are very education specific. They're not necessarily dyslexic specific. There are a couple there that are for the dyslexic community, but they're for all learners, and a lot of special ed learners are obviously in that group as well. So we're going to start with the Livescribe hardware, and we're going to talk about three different components of our hardware solution: the smart pen, the dot paper, and our headsets. We currently have two models of smart pens. So I don't know how many of you might be following Livescribe, but on Monday we were very, very excited to announce the release of our new Sky Wi-Fi smart pen. And so we have a Wi-Fi solution that allows you to upload your notes to your computer wirelessly without having to plug into any USB cord. And then we still have over here our Echo model, which is a wired solution. And that's a little bit lower cost pen. You can see these are the MSRP, meaning just the standard prices. There's no volume discounts, no education discounts or anything. This is like if you were to go to Best Buy and pay full price for it, that's what they would be. And so you can see that the wired product is our lower end product, but a lot of educators love it. They don't necessarily need the Wi-Fi connection in order to upload their notes. And they don't mind, you know, having the wire, and that, and they can save quite a bit of money. I will be talking about both models throughout this presentation, and I will be asking you at one point, I've got a video to show you how they work on pen and paper, and I'll have you guys vote on which one, which video we should watch. And we could always watch both too. So even if you like both, we can do it. So let's first talk about the smart pen. There is actually a computer inside of this pen, and then I want to just take you through all the components that make it smart. So at the very, very top, there's a power button to turn the pen on and off. You'll see an OLED display underneath it, which tells you different information depending on what you're doing. So if you're recording, it will tell you how long you've been recording. If you're playing back, it'll have a timeline. And then underneath there, you might see this little dot right here. That little dot is a microphone. So that microphone is recording all of the audio that's being spoken in the room at the time that you tap record on your paper, which you'll see a video of that occurring in a few minutes. And what it's doing is it's linking everything that's being recorded through the microphone to what's being captured down here on the bottom. I'm going to go over here to the side image. There's a little camera. So underneath the inktip, there's a little camera inside that glass window. And that camera is recording all of your handwriting. So the computer inside the pen is digitizing your handwriting, digitizing, obviously, the audio. It's capturing that in a recording. But it's also linking those two together. And that's what makes this such an incredibly powerful solution for students, because they don't have to rewind and fast forward and remember, you know, where in the point of the lecture that they heard that important point. They could just tap right on their notes and play back from that moment in time. They start the audio from the moment that they wrote that word or wrote that letter. And that's all occurring inside the pen, that correlation between the audio and the written text. Now, underneath the microphone, there's a speaker. So you'll see here these little slashes on the side. That's a speaker. So if you do not have a pair of headsets plugged into your smart pen, you will actually hear the pen play right through the speaker out loud. Now, you do have an option if you come over here. This is the top of the pen. So if you were to go in up on this top right here, this is what you would see. There's a headphone jack. This is a standard 3.5 millimeter headphone jack. So all of the standard audio equipment out there, like if you have iPhone speakers, maybe like external speakers for your computer, that's your standard size. You can plug those into your smart pen as well. So if you wanted to amplify the sound with speakers, you could utilize that, or you can plug in a pair of headsets and then listen to the audio via your headsets and not have it play through the mic of the speaker right here. Now, over here on the right-hand side, you'll also see that it has a USB cord. And so if the in referring to the Echo model, which is the lower-end model that's wired, you would connect with your USB cord to your computer in order to upload your notes. In addition, the USB cord is going to be how you charge your pen. So there is an internal rechargeable battery, and so you just plug it into the USB port on your computer, or you could use an AC power adapter that has a USB charge at the end, and you can charge your pen via that way as well. With the Sky Smart Pen, you will not need to connect it to your computer in order to upload the notes. That would occur wirelessly, but you would need to connect the cable to charge your pen. So you are still provided with a USB cord in the box of the Sky Wi-Fi Pen in order to charge it. And then the last piece that is in your box when you order your pen is a cap. You actually get two of them, and they just slip on right within this little well right here to cover up the camera as well as the ink so that it does not dry out and it protects the camera. So those are what's come in the box, along with two ink cartridges. The ink cartridges are removable, so they are replaceable. You just kind of slide them on out, either grab them with your fingertips, or you can get a little pin-nose pliers if yours are in there kind of tight, and you can replace your ink tips. We provide ink in blue, black, and red colors, and they come in fine and medium points. In addition, later on in the presentation, I'll be talking about common uses. And you'll see that one of the common uses is to use your smart pen with sound stickers. And sound stickers are little circle stickers that you can attach anywhere, and you can provide audio recordings. And so when the student goes up and taps that sticker, then they would hear the pen play. And so a lot of times they'll put a metal stylus tip. So that's the other tip that you could fit into this little part right here, is a metal stylus tip so that they're not writing on the surface when they activate the audio playback. All right, we're going to move on now and talk about the headsets. Now, I just shared with you that we do have a standard 3.5 millimeter jack, so you can use any headsets on the market in order to listen to the recording. These are the headsets that we sell, and I like to point them out to people because they do have microphones embedded in them. So you'll see on this side right here with that little dot, that's a microphone. And the microphone that they embed into the headsets is developed by the chief scientists at Bose, and it uses the noise-canceling technology that Bose developed for their headphones. And so it's going to cut down on unwanted noise like the HVAC, like air conditioning or heating systems. The other thing that it does in wearing the headphones is it moves the microphone source away from the tip of the pen. And so I just want to point out that your microphone is right here and the tip of your pen is about 2 to 3 inches below the microphone. So if you're recording with this microphone, one of the things that does happen that I like to point out, especially when working with students with special needs, is that it'll pick up the scratchy sound of the ink tip going across the paper. Now, it all depends on the user. Some users don't write very heavily, and so they get a really barely discernible sound, and it doesn't bother them at all. Other users really press hard with the ink tip, and it makes a lot of sound when it's going across the paper, and the microphone's going to pick that scratchy sound up. So if you have a child that you're working with that's really sensitive, if they have sensory issues and they're sensitive to that sound in the background of using the pen, then I would very highly recommend getting the Livescribe headsets. And then what I instruct people to do is just plug them in while you're recording. I know that's, you know, most people go, why would I put headsets in while I'm recording? But it's because of that microphone. And then just drape them around your neck. So I usually just lay them right here. I put them around my neck and drape them because obviously we don't want students going to class and having headphones in their ears while they're recording. Okay, so just drape around their neck. And then that's moving that microphone source about 2 feet away from the ink tip. And you're going to cut down on that scratchy sound, as well as get a superior sound to your audio through the enhanced microphones. The last piece of our hardware solution is our dot paper product line. You do need to use Livescribe dot paper in order for all of this to work. And so we don't want it to be a drawback for anybody, so we do provide printable notepads free of charge. They're PDF files, so if you go to livescribe.com/support, there's a downloadable PDF file that you can get to print out your notepads. If you've got an Echo Smart Pen, they're also in the Livescribe desktop software, so you can go right there and you can download it from there. And so, so that is one solution. But our notebooks are not that bad. Like down here, this is the common notebook that students use. They come in a 4-pack. There's 100 pages both sides, 200 pages of writing surface all together, and they're $24.95 for 4. So they break down to about $6.25 a piece, which is not that much more than the standard notebooks that they're buying for class anyway. So we do have dot paper in lots of different sizes. Here's your 8.5x11 that I spoke about. When you purchase a smart pen, you do get the A5 size, which is about a 6x9-inch notebook. It's a little bit smaller. And so some people really do like that size. Other people prefer to go out and get the larger size notepads, depending on what they're using them for. The A5 size notebook also comes in a grid paper. So if students are in any type of math class that they're doing graphing or a CAD or architecture class where they're doing a lot of drawings, they can go out and get that grid paper. And then speaking of art classes, I do like to point out that we have our paper, our journals. The journals are the only thing that come in no lines. And so if you're working with a student that's got fine motor coordination issues and they write really large and the college ruled lines that are in all the rest of these solutions are too small for them, this is your best solution in terms of being able to get an unlined piece of paper. Unfortunately, we don't have any paper in that primary lined or larger rule lined than college. And so just be aware of that with your students that have writing difficulties. And these are just some of our smaller papers over here. You'll see that we have sticky notes as well as this is a very tiny journal. It's about the size of a picture, like a 4x6 picture. And we have a flip pad as well. And I've seen the flip pads used by a lot of special ed departments for students that are autistic and nonverbal. I don't know what if you work in that community at all beyond what the dyslexic community, but they'll actually create their own little AAC device, like an alternative communication device, by filling up that little notepad with pertinent information. And then the student just has to go out with the little notepad in their pen, and if they come to somebody that they need to verbalize to, they can tap on that notepad and play back that audio. Okay, so we're going to see how all of that works in a second. So with that, I want to move on to show you how recording notes and audio works. So now that you know the three different parts of the solution and what you need in order to make this solution work, I want to show you the actual recording. And so this is where we get to vote. Do you want to see the video of the Echo Smart Pen, which is the wired model, or would you prefer the Sky Smart Pen over here on the right, which is the wireless model? They're a little bit different, but not much. Go ahead and type in there and just write either Echo or Sky. I knew you guys were going to do this. It's virtually an even split. All right, in order to be fair, Sky's taking the lead. Oh, no, Echo just came in with one. It literally is about an even split. All right, in order to be fair to both sides, they're very, very short. They're literally about a minute and 30 seconds. Why don't we just go for both of them? Then at least you can see the very subtle differences. But other from the recording and playback standpoint, they're not.
Smart Pen from Livescribe. What makes it smart? It records everything you hear, write, and draw, and links the audio to your notes. Just tap on your notes to replay what was said at that point in time. It records everything you hear, write, and draw. Tap on your notes to replay what was said at that point in time. Here's how it works. First, tap the record button in your notebook. The Smart Pen starts recording everything you hear and write. Write notes, draw a diagram, mark important stuff. Then tap stop to finish recording. Later, you can replay the audio by tapping on your notes.
The Smart Pen
speed up or slow them down as you need.
Everything you hear and write. Write note.
Draw a diagram.
To get exactly what you need.
Mark important stuff.
One Smart Pen, huh?
Okay, that was the Echo Pen, and this is really good for you to see because the Sky Pen at this point in time is not very different at all from the experience that you had with the Echo Pen. The one thing I like about the Echo video is it does point out the playback speed, and that's something I definitely want to talk about for your community of students that you work with. And I'll get to that at the end of the Sky video when I show you the playback controls up close. The Sky video is not going to show the playback speed, but it works with it. So don't be afraid that it's not in the video.
Recorded audio and see how it wirelessly transfers to your Evernote account. To begin, use your starter notebook and tap the record button at the bottom of the page. Write the number 1 on your paper, and as you write it, say your full name.
Tina Neptrams.
Now, write the number 2. And as you write it, say the city where you were born.
San Francisco.
When you're finished, tap the stop button. Your Smart Pen will automatically start to sync, wirelessly sending your recorded notes and audio to Evernote. When your Smart Pen has finished syncing, you can create more notes or go back and review them. Simply tap on your notes to hear the audio playback from that exact moment in time.
Tina Neptrams. San Francisco.
So one of the things I love about how they do the Sky video is that they really show you that 1 and that 2. When she said her name, number 1, and then she said the where she grew up, number 2. And one of the things that I like to point out is if the user had tapped on number 2, it would have jumped right to the audio recording San Francisco and started playing back from there. But because in the video they tapped on the number 1, you heard them say their name, and then there was a pause while they were writing the number 2, and then you heard her say San Francisco. But everything that you write on that paper is basically indexed to the audio, so you could jump right to that location in the audio by tapping on that particular handwriting or that written note. So I just want to review with you the steps that they went through in both videos because they work the same exact way. You tap the record button at the bottom. So this is a sample of a piece of paper from our Echo Smart Pen. Okay, so but these controls are in both Echo and Sky. They just tap this record button right here on the bottom. And then they go ahead and write as they normally would. So if I was learning about the Smart Pen, I'd take my notes about the Smart Pen, take my notes about the headset, take my notes about the dot paper. Okay, so they write notes just like they normally would. So in terms of learning how to use this technology, there's a real minimal learning curve. It's a matter of teaching them about the controls on the bottom because otherwise all they're doing is taking notes as they normally would. And then at the end of the session, they would tap stop. Now, the one thing that really works well with the dyslexic community, though, is teaching them a little bit alternative note-taking method. So a lot of times, these students cannot write a lot of notes and keep time with the instruction. They get overwhelmed trying to multitask. They're trying to listen to their teacher speak or their professor speak at the same time that they're trying to write. I mean, even for people without dyslexia, that's a really difficult task in terms of what it's doing in our brains. And so what I really recommend to users that work with these students is to teach them how to just capture the key words. So in this example here, I know this is so hard for you to see. It's almost in the background. Like it's my notes about this presentation. So it's SmartPen with a bunch of notes underneath, headsets with a bunch of notes, and then dot paper with a bunch of notes. If I was working with a community of learners that had difficulty with note-taking or fine motor problems, I would tell them just write the three key words. Just write SmartPen. Just write headsets, and then just write dot paper. You know, if you're in a classroom and they're teaching about the life cycle of a butterfly, just write, you know, the egg, the caterpillar, the chrysalis, you know, and then the butterfly. And then leave blocks of space in between. Leave some space for you to add additional notes. Because what happens is when you finish, you are now have the handwriting correlated to your audio recording. And so anywhere you tap on your handwriting, it'll start to play back. So if I tap on the word SmartPen right here, it'll start to play back what it recorded about the SmartPen. And then what I can do is I can add these notes later. I don't have to add them on the first round. I can do it while I'm reviewing. So I can add these notes in. And if I add those notes while my pen is playing, those new notes are still synced to the audio that's playing on the SmartPen. Even though I never hit the record button, it was just playing on my pen, and as I added additional notes in while that pen was playing, everything I'm writing is being indexed to the audio that's playing. So it's indexed to the audio that's playing out the speaker at the time when you write. And so now what you have are what we call layered notes. You're layering in additional information, you know, when it's convenient to you so that you can focus on instruction, focus when you're there with the teacher. Just get down those key words, though, so you've got a starting point to, you know, tap on to start that playback. And then later when you're reviewing your notes, layer the additional notes in. And we find that it works so well with dyslexic learners to have that audio backup and not have to rely so heavily on the written word. It just helps their processing because they are very strong auditory processors very often. So with that, I do want to go through the paper replay controls that are on the bottom of the page. Now, these are not that different between Sky and Echo. The one thing you might have noticed in the Sky video is all they did was change this little icon here. They made it a little bit more appealing, but they also took out the bookmark feature. So I'm going to explain what the bookmark feature is in a few seconds, and if you find that to be an extremely important feature, then just realize that it only comes in the Echo notebook, not the Sky notebook, okay? So the first one we talked about already is the pause button, I mean the record button, which we already know starts the recording, but right next to the record button is the pause button. You can pause during both the recording and playback. So if a student was in class and they were given a break or something and they just want to pause the recording, they can, but more importantly, especially for the learners you work with, you can pause during playback. So if they are listening back to instruction and they can't layer in those notes while listening, they could always just pause the playback, write additional notes, and then click on pause again in order to unpause it and continue it playing. And so that is extremely helpful to these students in note-taking because they're not trying to do two things at once. They're not trying to listen to the playback and write. We talked about the stop button, that it ends the recording session, but just recognize it ends playback as well. So if you're listening and need to stop the playback, you can. The jump buttons right here, these next set of buttons, these will jump in the recording in 10-second increments. So if you tap on this forward button, it will jump 10 seconds forward, and then if you tap on this back button, it'll jump 10 seconds back. And that's a real crucial piece for note takers because we all know in note taking, you don't start note taking until you've heard something really important. So the teacher says something important and then you write it down. Well, in the meantime, the teacher's moved on. And so you have to really think about where you're tapping maybe isn't what you really want to hear. You want to just jump back about 10 seconds where the teacher started making that crucial point and then that you're going to hear what the person said that was so important when you decided to write it down. You can also hold down on these buttons. If you tap and hold, it will actually speed jump through your recording. All right, the next one are the bookmarks. The bookmarks are audio flags. So let's say, and I love this feature, and I have to be honest with you, I was so heartbroken and sad that they didn't put it in the new Sky notebooks. But, you know, if you love Sky, one little caveat I should tell you, if you love Sky, but you want this feature, you can buy the other notebooks, and the Sky Pen will work with them. It's just not in the notebook that comes in the box. So the bookmark feature are audio flags. So let's say you've got a student that can't even get those keywords down. They can't even write smart pen, dot paper, and headsets. That's too much for them. But they still need a way to flag important information in their notes. They can create audio bookmarks. So this little star right here, that first one, will create a flag in the audio. And you'll see it in the timeline. There'll be a little tick mark on the OLED display of your smart pen. There'll be a tick mark in that timeline that that will play back that bookmark from that moment in time. And then you can create as many as you want. So now you've got flags on all of your key points. And so these two buttons to the right of the star, the one with the arrows along with the star, those just jump ahead a bookmark or jump back a bookmark. So you can jump to those crucial places in the instruction where you wanted to review or knew it was an important point or the teacher said it's going to be on a test. And you can jump to those with the audio flags and not need any writing at all on the page besides one initial mark just to start the playback. So I usually tell people, as soon as you hit record, make a check at the top of the page. And then that's your moment of beginning. That's where everything began, and you can get back to that moment of beginning really quickly. The next set of controls are the jump to position. So, you know, the jump button is great when you want to get somewhere that's close by, but let's say you have a 3-hour-long recording and you want to start it midway through. Well, then you could just tap on the middle here, and that would take you halfway through the recording. So regardless of the length of the recording, if it was 10 minutes, it would take you to the 5-minute mark. If it was 3 hours, it would take you to the hour and a half mark. And then you've got everything, you know, fractionally incremental in the way, on the way. These playback speeds, I really want to talk about these. I know you saw them in the Echo video, but these are going to be crucial for your learners because a lot of times they can't process instruction at the pace at which the teacher is delivering it. And they need to slow down the teacher just a little bit. So this is probably one of the most important points of our product for you to consider for your learners. When you tap on the minus button, it's going to decrease the playback speed in 10% increments. So you'll see here for minus, you can tap it up to 5 times. The first time takes you down to 90, then 80, 70, 60, and the bottom speed is 50% of the normal recording speed. And so those students that have processing issues really find that beneficial just to slow it down a little bit. But we do have students on the opposite end of the spectrum, so there is a plus, and that will increase the playback speed in 20% increments. So you'll go from 120 up to 200 times the original original speed that you recorded at. And the button in the middle will take you back to the normal recorded speed, so whatever it was, regardless of where you are in the continuum, it'll go back to normal. And then finally, we have two volume buttons to increase and decrease the volume. Those work either if you have the headsets in or the speaker. And at the very end, this is a mute button that will mute your microphone but will not mute your speaker. So I do get that question often, is there a way to mute something that I don't want to get recorded or edited? There is not. So it doesn't mute the speaker, it doesn't mute the microphone, it only mutes the speaker. Okay? So with that, I want to do a video where we actually hear from a dyslexic student that uses a smart pen in a high school class. And so
I have dyslexia, and in school with the Livescribe pen, I usually am able to go back and listen to it over again instead of having the pressure of hearing it once in class and then that's the only time I can hear it. Like, I can hear it again later when I get home or just even right after that class because it's on the pen.
The differences for my daughter in learning with the pen versus without the pen, number one is the reduction in stress and the comfort level, but it allows her to review just what she needs. She can hear it and she can read it. And the more senses that a student can use in a day, the more likely they are to remember a concept or what they're studying.
If you have dyslexia, one of the things you have trouble with is processing fast enough what a teacher's saying. They actually tend to be very good auditory learners, but then the problem is, if that's all they're getting to do is hear, and they don't get it written down, then they don't have something to look at that night and can't recall it in the same manner.
Having dyslexia, it's almost like you don't really catch on, in my opinion, as fast as the other students. As the teacher speaks, you have to kind of process it a little bit more and kind of deeper to really understand the concept.
The worst thing you can do, I think, having had a brother with dyslexia, is make them have to write stuff while the teacher's talking, because their auditory part is the part that is their greatest strength. On the other hand, they still need to have something when they go home at night to look at to refresh. And this PenCast allows this to happen. It allows a student who has dyslexia to be able to hear and see what I've said.
Sometimes I have no clue what I just read, but hearing Mrs. Crowley say it and write it, and you're watching it and listening to it, it just clicks a lot easier, and you can just understand it.
The impact that the Livescribe pen can have on a learning different child and on the school as a whole is tremendous. It reduces their stress. I can't say enough how important that is. It allows them to have multiple opportunities to hear the lesson, which allows the learning to stick. The issue is getting information to stick in their brains in a way that they can retrieve it. The best way to improve the retrieval process is for them to hear it, see it, and do it over and over again. And the pen allows that.
All of us have some kind of learning difference on the continuum. There's lots of learning style inventories that are out there. And the perfect one is if you can somehow have a blend of everything, be auditory, be mathematical, be creative, etc. But none of us typically are that perfect blend. So again, this PenCast allows anybody, no matter where they are on the continuum, whether they're a very visual learner or they're the opposite, a very auditory, this takes care of both of that for them.
All right, sorry that that was freezing up on you. What I will do is I will send Sandy the link. That video is available on YouTube, and so it was really freezing up and choppy there at the end of it. But if you do want to view it again, we can provide the link to you on YouTube in order for you to view that on your own, so you don't have that choppiness, okay? So with that, it is a large file, you're right, because that's a 3-minute video. Sorry, Chad. So with that, I just want to move on and talk about digital notes. Like in the video, you probably heard the students just say all they needed was to play it back right off of the pen. And you know, a large portion of our users never even digitize their notes, never take them up to the computer, and don't even use this aspect of the solution. But I just want to make you aware of this aspect of the solution. If you have a student that's all they need, they just need to be able to play it back, and they just need to tap on their handwriting and play it back and take additional notes, then that's great. Don't even burden them with this element of the solution. But as people, you know, responsible for talking about the product and helping people, I just wanted to expose this to you. Now, this slide didn't come out so well, but you've already been introduced to the Echo Smart Pen, and you've been introduced to the Skype Smart Pen. And just to review, the major difference is the Echo Smart Pen utilizes a wired approach to uploading notes and uses our Livescribe desktop software, which is a software that lives on your computer. It's a free download. Anyone can go download the software from Livescribe.com. There's no cost for the software. It only works if you have a pen, so you do have to purchase the pen. But the software, there's no cost for. And so all of your notes from the Echo Pen go to the Livescribe desktop software. Our new Sky Wi-Fi Smart Pen is a Wi-Fi pen, so we wanted to offer our users a cloud-based solution. So we partnered with Evernote, and I don't know how many of you are familiar with Evernote, but I'll show you a little bit about it. They are the leader in online note-taking storage and cloud-based storage for your notes and files. They're up there amongst like Dropbox and I'm trying to think of the other one I'm spacing on right now. Google Drive, that was the other one I was thinking about. So they're a cloud-based service for storing everything. So we've partnered where our notes go immediately up to your Evernote account. And I've got slides on both because it really sounds like we are a split group here in terms of our interest. So here's a screen grab of the Livescribe desktop software, and I'm going to take you through a few elements of this. It looks a little overwhelming at first, but it's pretty simple to use because you've got your notebooks over here on the left. This is where all of your notebooks are listed, so you can have multiple notebooks if you need to at the same time on a pen. And then over here are your little thumbnail sketches of all of your pages. And when you want to play back the audio from any of your pages, you just click on the page to make it bigger, so you're only seeing one page at a time, and then you click on the handwriting, just like you do on your notebook. So it works exactly the same as if you took the tip of your pen and you tapped on the handwriting to play back. You're just using your mouse. You use your mouse, you tap on your handwriting, and it begins playback. And you actually see the strokes of your handwriting animated with animated ink strokes, okay? Now, there's a couple of nice features about the software that can be helpful to people. There is a search tool built into the software. So if you do teach your users to use that keyword approach where they're writing the keyword in their notes, you can type that keyword into the search tool and it will scan your handwritten notes and locate that page of notes on your computer. So if the student is studying for a final exam and they took notes, early in the semester back in September, and they've lost that notebook, in the interim, they can still have a digital version or a digital backup of those notes on their desktop, on their computer, and then when they want to review the butterfly, they just type in the keyword butterfly and they jump right to that page. And so that's a really nice feature in helping people get organized. You also have the ability to create custom notebooks. Chad says we love Evernote. I saw that in the chat box. It is a great tool. So I'm glad that you guys will be happy about our partnership with them. But you do have the ability to do custom notebooks. So if you want to organize your notes and not lug around five different notebooks, one for every class, just lug around one, and then you can just go ahead and organize the notes by clicking and dragging the pages into custom notebooks. And then down here, we've got Livescribe Connect, and this is how you can share your notes. So we do have like students in the higher ed institutions that have note takers for their accommodation. So if depending on their disability, they might be provided a note taker. So a lot of times the note taker will just send either the Disability Support Services Center or the student directly the notes in a digital format with audio. And so that's all done through Livescribe Connect, and it's very easy to do right out of the software. So it makes that a lot more streamlined of a process. This is the Evernote software. So this is if you were to use the Sky Smart Pen, okay? So this is it. Over here on the left, you'll see these are where all your notebooks are. And then they, too, have the ability to search and tag. Now, Livescribe Connect, Livescribe desktop software from the Echo does not have the ability for tagging, but Evernote does. And tagging is where you tag your notes with keywords. So this has to be done after the fact. So after the notes upload from your wireless pen, you can then go into the note pages and choose, like, this note, for example, and I could tag this Evernote because this note is about Evernote. And then I can search and filter. So when I click on any of the tags in this list, it would only show me the notes that have that tag. So you can filter your notes out by tags. In addition, though, if you don't take the time to tag all of your notes, you do still have a keyword search up here on the top. So you can still type in a word, and it will actually scan all of your handwriting as well as any images that you've uploaded to Evernote. One of the things I love about Evernote over Livescribe Desktop is that I can store anything in here, not just my Livescribe notes. So if I'm trying to put like my PowerPoint presentation that my teacher shared with me and my Word document that I created notes on and maybe I grabbed an image off the internet related to the unit of study, I can put all those things in Evernote all together in one custom folder. So you can create custom notebooks in Evernote as well, and then drag all that stuff in along with your handwritten notes and audio that you did with your smart pen. So as a cloud solution, it's a lot more robust because you're not limited to just what you've created with the Livescribe smart pen. And then you have, this probably should have been the first one, you've got notebooks and stacks in order to organize all of your notes. So just like you had in Livescribe Desktop. Over here on the right, you'll see that you also have the ability to share notes through Evernote. So just like in Livescribe Desktop where you had Livescribe Connect in order to share, in Evernote, you could use the features of Evernote in order to share that note on Evernote. And then you can even share an entire notebook. So you can choose a notebook and choose to share the whole notebook. And then you have the choice to either share it with just an individual, you put in their email address, and then if they have access to it, they can get to it in their Evernote account, and then or just do a public link where anybody with the link can actually go get that note. So with that, I just want to finish up with a couple of other common uses beyond just your community of learners. You might get a few ideas from these. I'll just take about 5 minutes on these, and then we will stop at about 2:50 for questions and answers. So I do see questions popping in to the chat that Sandy is monitoring, so she's getting those all down. So if questions are on your mind, go ahead and put those in while I go through the last little section of our presentation. There are 5 techniques that I talk about in terms of using the SmartPen with all learners. We've been talking a lot today about note-taking. You know, note-taking is definitely a major use of it. So no matter where you are, you know, I go to doctor's appointments with my SmartPen. I have a son that's got issues that he has to go see a specialist for, and sometimes I'm overwhelmed at those appointments. He's throwing things out that I need to research and I need to, you know, talk about with my mom because she's an RN, and I take notes at the doctor's appointment. And my funny story is I went back for a follow-up visit and the doctor actually went out and bought a SmartPen after seeing me take notes of the appointment. So I thought that was kind of really funny over at Johns Hopkins. But obviously in any class, any meeting, anywhere you go, you could take notes. The next topic I want to talk about is pen casting. Pen casting is a little bit different than note taking. This is when you're taking the notes with the pen and the paper, but then you're sharing them. You're actually sharing those notes. So we talk a lot to teachers about pen casting. Teachers that are teaching in a flipped classroom, you know, where they're providing instruction for homework through videos or pen casts, and then the students doing practice in class. This is just another way for them to capture instruction. So they're using their pen and paper in order to annotate what they're teaching. This is a big thing for math teachers. It's probably our number one user community in terms of teachers is math, because they can show them how to solve a quadratic equation and get down every little element of that, you know, equation and not be limited by their computers. You know, typing math equations on a computer is difficult. So they capture all that while they're speaking out loud. And that becomes a little mini tutorial for their students. So if you could get teachers to turn on to this, they could create tutorials that then they can make available to their students either through their learning management center or a web page or a blog. And then your students could then view the teacher's tutorial taught in the way that the teacher wants it taught as a way for them to have another review besides just their own handwritten notes. One of the things I'd like to talk about are the large 8.5 by 11 notebooks. You can rip that paper out. All of the paper in that notebook is perforated, so you can rip it right down the perforation and not get the little spiral, you know, jagged edges. And then you can send that through a printer. So really think about this. This opens up a lot of possibilities, and I think a lot of them will be related to your community. But you can print anything on top of that dot paper. So I talked to reading specialists that do fluency assessments, and they print the assessment onto the paper, and then they capture that reading fluency assessment data right with the SmartPen. But we also have students that have accommodations, and this might be some of the children that you work with. They might have a test-taking accommodation where they need to have the test read aloud to them. Well, what the teacher does is they print the test onto the dot paper, they tap record, make a little bullet mark or a check mark in front of the question, and then they say the question out loud, and then they tap stop. So when the student goes and taps on that little question check mark, they hear the question read aloud. And then they continue to do that, obviously, for the whole test, all the answers and all the questions. And so now the student can be far more independent in their test taking if they have that accommodation, because they just sit in the back of the room with a pair of headsets and a pen and listen to the test as many times as they want. They don't need an aid for that, which is a very costly solution for schools, and it gives them independence. So they're not embarrassed to ask if they, you know, that with the aid, they might not want to ask the aid to repeat it 10 times, but with the pen, they'll do it because they're not getting embarrassed. Obviously, if students have pens in a class, they can create their own study guides. We have speech-language therapists that print worksheets onto the dot paper, so they've got, their articulation drills and therapy that they pre-record that the student can then access. And it works great for ELL learners, too, that they're trying to learn intonation of a language or how things are expressed. You can record that as well. Any forms, you know, that you use, we know administrators that use walkthrough forms, but here's that example of using the dot paper as an AAC device for nonverbal kids. So this is something I created right in Microsoft Word, and then I just make a little dot in front of each word and then say it out loud, and then when you tap on the dot, it's going to play back that word. But obviously, you can put anything you want on there in order to create a communication device for students. And then we have teachers that do lesson plans as well. And then the last thing I want to end on is just some of our alternative dot paper products. So these are not necessarily paper, like note-taking paper. We obviously have our sticky notes, but one of our favorite products, and I hate this little thing down at the bottom, this does not currently work with Sky. Just to warn all of you, if you're going to run out and get Sky Smart Pens, they don't have it working with Sky. We just released Sky on Monday, so it's a brand new product, and they're due to have this fixed by Q1 of next year, so the January to March timeframe. But these are our sound stickers, and they are phenomenal. You hit record right up here, you tap on the sticker, you record. Now, I know I saw a question in there, what's the max recording time? There are three models of pens, 2 GB, 4 GB, and 8 GB for Sky. The Echo Smart Pen did come in a 2, 4, and 8 gigabyte model. There are still 4 and 8 gigabytes available, but we end the life of the 4 and the 8 on Monday. So they are old products. So you might get a great deal on them. I'm just warning you. Might get a great deal, like at Best Buy might be trying to move all that inventory out now that Sky came out on Monday. I know you can get some refurbished units on Livescribe.com, and they're definitely around still. But right now, the only product we're keeping in the market is the 2 gigabyte Echo. The 2 GB model of both Sky and Echo hold 200 hours of audio. The 4 GB model holds 400, and the 8 GB model holds 800 hours of audio. So that's your limit in terms of recording time. Or actually, I should say, your limit is your battery. It's not normally the pen. The pen's got plenty of space, but your battery is only good for 8 to 10 hours, and then you have to charge it on up. So unless you have it plugged in while you're recording, you really can't go for 200 hours. You have to charge the battery. So when you tap record, then you tap on the sticker, you can speak for as long as you want. I have two small children. I have a 3- and a 5-year-old, and we do this with their storybooks. You know, all the books that I get at Walmart or Target for $3 or $4, we put a sticker on every page, and then we record it. So when I'm out on the road and I'm not here for their nighttime stories, they can listen to mommy through their pen. And so just to share a few other ideas on how people are using those sound stickers, you know, here's one of my daughter's books that I recorded for her, and she loves putting the stickers on the page. She just turned 5. But we have people that do direction dots. Like, these are directions on how to connect a projector, but we have teachers that put a little sticker on their back table, put a piece of packing tape over it, like clear shipping tape, and they reuse that sticker all year long. Because one of the things I forgot to point out is over here, there's a little garbage can right here, so you can delete the audio off a sticker as well. And so they just re-record the directions for their center activity each time they change it, and then they can use that sticker all year long. We have visually impaired students that use tactile markers or braille to locate the sound sticker, and then they know the sticker's right to the right of it, and then they could tap on it to get the auditory instruction. Anything that you can put a sticker on, you can audio enhance, whether it's a map in a classroom, a word wall, or a bulletin board. Murals that the students have created for a project can have stickers on them that speak. Flashcards that you bought at the store, if you're using any type of purchased device that you want to add audio to. Obviously, using your sticky notes and textbooks is phenomenal because we don't want students writing in a textbook nor putting a sticker on there, so we recommend the sticky notes for that. And then I've even seen special ed teachers use them as behavior modifications, where this was a student who was really motivated by music. And so he had a book of recorded songs, and that was his reward, that he could go listen to one of his songs on the Smart Pen if he behaved or performed in a certain way. So with that, I do see lots of questions coming in. I'm going to hand it back to Sandy.
That was terrific, Janet. I've got a lot of ideas now. That was really great. So one of the things that that Lexercise does, in addition to working with students in reading and spelling and writing, is to coach assistive technologies and to match up students' assistive technology needs. So I think we've got a lot of better ideas for how we might do that in our online treatment after today's session. That was really terrific. We do a lot of work with Evernote, as Chad mentioned, and a lot of work with Learning Ally, and now I think we've got our toolbox